Hello, and welcome to the Wheel of Crime podcast. This podcast is ran by two ladies who play games, mumble profanities, and laugh way too often. Also, this podcast does cover topics of sensitive nature, and as such, listener discretion is advised.
Hello, and welcome back to the Wheel of Crime podcast. My name is Jen.
My name is Emily. Yes, welcome back to another week.
It do be like that. It do be another week here in the podcast land.
Once again, the world keeps spinning and time keeps moving forward at its pace that it does. As per usual, nothing's changed on that front. But yes, so
that's about it. I honestly don't really have any new life updates. My week was pretty boring. I worked as usual, but it's March now. I mean, it's been March for like a minute, but like it's March.
Yep, and for where we live, it is still stupid snowy outside, stupid icy. I literally almost did a backflip directly into the pavement, hot and fresh yesterday.
It's true. She came over to my apartment building, and for some unknown reason, they put fucking a laminate flooring on the outside step, so anytime it snows or rains, it's like a literal death trap.
See, and I went into it really genuinely not realizing at all what was going on, and I was like, oh, yes, and confidently took a step forward and then immediately went into the splits. So, for somebody who's not very flexible, not Gucci. Did not love that for myself.
Yeah, not gonna lie, I've almost fallen, like, face first off that step about a million times at this point. Specifically this winter, I don't know what it is about that step, but it's like a thousand times more slippery than usual.
Slippy slip. Yeah. Yeah, and then, I don't know, for updates for myself, I honestly haven't really been doing anything outside of working, and, I don't know. Like, March is kind of a weird time of year because it's, like, moving into the spring, but there's not really, like, lots to do other than work or school or whatever people are doing. So, I don't know.
Yeah, March, I feel like, is one of those weird months where it's, like, it's almost spring, so you're kind of excited, but it's, like, feels like the tail end of February has been lingering for a while.
February genuinely feels like it's 6 months long.
Legit.
It's not even an exaggeration.
It's not. I don't understand, but it's the worst month, I've decided.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And I don't know. I'm trying to think if there was anything else that happened last week that I haven't mentioned, but like, I don't know. We tried to go to an Anastasia musical together.
Oh, God.
And apparently, so it was rescheduled due to COVID in January for March. And one would assume that if you were scheduling from January to March, that would mean March as in a couple months away. Not March of next year. But it do be like that. And it was, in fact, scheduled for next year. And we had no clue.
It's true. Apparently, the play is March 2023, and that is a very confusing to me. And we walked there, and there was many other people waiting outside the theater being like, what is happening? And it then dawned on us that it was not today, but a year from today. So that's fun.
At least we know it's exactly a year from today. We have no excuses to be late, I guess.
It's true. We know exactly where we need to be a year from today.
So we can plan really far ahead of time.
To be at this fucking musical.
Literally. And, yeah, I don't know. Like, that was basically it for me, other than, like I said, the work stuff. And then I tried my hand at, like, painting some pottery, and lo and behold, not talented at all. My work definitely looks like a pile of hot garbage. And yeah, I don't know. I feel like that's really basically been my week.
You know what? That's fair. I don't know. It's been a week. Would you like to get into our wheel of questions?
I would absolutely love to get into our wheel of questions.
All right, spin away, Em. Who was your favorite artist or band in middle school?
Middle school?
Yes.
See, I feel like in middle school, I was much more... I didn't really have my own taste figured out yet. It was more so what other people I, like, listened to at the time, and I'd be like, oh, yeah, I like this music. So, for myself, probably some a cross between Headley and Marianas Trench and Maroon 5 and Kesha and... I'm trying to think. One Republic, maybe? Like, it's just... Yeah, I don't know. Oh, Down with Webster, maybe? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that's it. I don't know. I was never a Justin Bieber person. I was never with the Biebs.
That's something I did know about you.
Yeah. And yeah, I think that was it for myself. What about you? Then I'd like to hear... I think I can guess... Definitely Taylor Swift.
Yes. In middle school, I started getting into Taylor Swift. Still obsessed with her to this day. So not much has changed on that regard. But I think, like you, I hadn't really developed much of like a taste yet. So I did listen to quite a mishmash of things. I definitely loved Kesha. I was pretty obsessed with both of her albums, Animal... and Cannibal, I think, was the other one.
That sounds about right.
And then I wasn't really a Justin Bieber person either. I, in fact, made it my personality to hate him. I don't know why, but I wasn't like other girls.
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah. Yeah, or like I do think though a lot of the appeal for people that we knew who listened to Jay Biebs was that they also thought he was really cute, which I'm gonna be honest, I never ever did. I was like, he just looks like every other white boy. Like, there's nothing really all that above greatness in my opinion, but I also have a weird taste in men from what I understand, so
yeah, I don't know, I wasn't super attracted to him either, so it didn't really appeal to me all that much. But I definitely knew a lot of people. I loved, like, Metric Station and, like, those random bands. Boys Like Girls.
Yep.
Trying to think about who else.
I listened to a lot of Matchbox 20.
Amazing. Bands of the early 2000s, my dudes.
Oh, shoot. I listened to a lot of Green Day. Oh, boy. I forgot about that. Like, especially in grade 9, I was, like, listening to Boulevard of Broken Dreams, like, on repeat. I wonder if I was going through something.
I think you were. I remember listening to Linkin Park quite a bit in the 9th grade because a boy I was, like, kind of, like, dating-ish, like, told me a song from them reminded him of me. And it was, like, kind of a depressing song. So I remember being, like... slightly offended, but I was like, it's okay, this makes him think of me.
I really want to know which one. I have to listen to it.
I will definitely have to show you later. It's not quite pod material, but it's definitely a private convo between the two of us.
I can't wait. I'm so excited.
All right, let's spin for our next question. What song from the 2009 to 2012 era of music was your favorite or is your favorite?
2009 to 2012.
See, I was a big TikTok gal, like by Kesha.
Oh, yep.
Or I was big into You Belong With Me by Taylor Swift. That was a huge one for me.
I don't know. My taste in music, though, I know I keep saying that, but I feel like I went between a lot of genres at the time, and I never really liked, like, I liked a lot of songs, I guess, but I don't know if I really had, like, an over-encompassing favorite for that time.
I remember, I think this was in grade, might have been grade 12 or grade 11 for us. Mm-hmm. You really liked this song, Twilight, by Thriving Ivory.
I did.
You're obsessed with that song.
Yeah, I was. So that would be one of them. Or I did also really like, what is it? Oh, well, seeing as we talked about this earlier, Sail by AWOL Nation was also a really good one.
Thrift Shop by Macklemore.
That was also a really good one.
I don't know what year that came out, but it was, like, in that era of time.
Oh, for sure, yeah. Or that was also the era of One Direction.
True, and the era of, like, Imagine Dragons' first album.
Ooh, yeah, we listened to Imagine Dragons a lot.
Their first album, I still listen to. I think it's actually a really great album. I haven't loved their newer stuff, so I really haven't listened to it at all. But that first album specifically is so nostalgic to that time for me.
No, I totally agree. I think, that album was really, really good. I did really like original Imagine Dragons. Or I went through a phase where I listened to, like, Olly Murs a lot.
Same.
Like, I went through this weird thing, I remember, where, like, I watched a lot of, like, British vloggers on YouTube. And so, like, because they were British, anything that was, like, a hip pop song in England at the time would always get recommended to me. So I listened to a lot of, like, random songs or songs from artists who were British during that time, too. Other than, of course, One Direction, because they were super big, too. But...
yeah. Were you big into Zoella, or which British YouTubers were you into?
No, I watched a lot of, I can't even really remember what their names are now. There was, like, a Tyler...
Oakley?
Tyler Oakley was one of them, and then there was another fellow. I'm pretty sure all of these people are gay men. I have not done any more research on them. I'm pretty sure. There was him, there was, like, another couple guys, like... there was this one guy, his name was, like, Alfalfa, Alfie or something.
That's Zoella's boyfriend.
Yeah, I watched him, but I didn't watch her. Then that's it.
See, I was more into, like, I watched Zoella occasionally. I was super into Bethany Moda at the time with her bows. I was obsessed with wearing bows.
I do remember that. That was cute. I don't know. I think that's it for, like, music, I'm pretty sure. But, like, if you were to show me music from that time period and, like, have me listen to a playlist, I could pick out, like...
your top five.
Oh, for sure, yep.
Yeah, that's fair. All right, let's spin for our next question. In 2009/2010, what new artist do you think had a major impact on the music world?
Between 2009-2010, so that would have been for us, like you were saying, around grade 8-ish.
It would be like grade 8.
Probably, I know for sure, for us in that time period, Lady Gaga got really big. And I know that, again, Kesha, and also for us, because we're Canadian, Mariana's Trench also got really big during that time.
Headley.
Panic at the Disco, but that was, like, pretty big for a few years, I feel. Adam Lambert.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That's really all I could think of.
Yeah, I would agree with your list. I feel like that's pretty on point.
Yeah, that's all I got. I got nothing else to contribute.
I would agree with you, so let's spin for our last question. What are your thoughts on artists being controlled by their labels? Because, like, for example, in, like, the past couple years, I know, like, K-pop has become super big. Mm-hmm. And there's been a lot of talk about how a lot of times they're really micromanaged by their labels, or it's the situation where it's, like, not great for them and they're being kind of very heavily controlled, or even, like, Britney with, like, her conservatorship thing.
Like, basically, they sell their name, their person, to the label, and they can't even get, like, a haircut or a tattoo or whatever, or, like, a piercing or change their hair color, I think I said that already, or like whatever, right? Without first running it past their label. Yeah, like that kind of stuff. So the question was, how do I feel about it?
Yes.
I think it's garbage. I think it defeats the purpose of having freedom. Well, it's taking away people's freedom of expression with the expectation that it will be financially profiting a management team. And for that, I feel like it takes away the rights of the artist to a unfair degree, and every person should be entitled to being able to make decisions regarding their person, whether or not that will be financially a contribution to their image or not. Do I understand why it exists? Of course. Yeah. Like, people make money off of, like, different aspects of what they can sell. If it's their face, if it's their body, if it's their personality, if it's a certain look, a certain haircut, whatever. But the whole point of being a person is being able to grow and change and be able to express yourself in different ways, because you're not going to be the same person forever. So, in a way, when labels do that kind of stuff, they're taking advantage of people and they're doing a hard sell on a certain aspect of a person and basically being like, yeah, this is the only way you can be defined for X amount of time because we profit off of it. And so for that, I don't like it. Again, I understand it. Don't like it.
Yeah, I just feel like it never ends well, and it, like, hugely takes advantage of the artist, and I don't like that. It is not the vibe, if you will.
I agree.
Yeah.
And you are totally right, though, especially with K-pop idols. I didn't even really think about that, but I know I had seen an article not that long ago. I forget who they were talking about, but there is a popular K-pop boy band, and one of the people in the boy band is, you know, the top figure for the troupe or whatever, where people hyper focus on him and have chosen him as like the most attractive one.
Mm-hmm.
And with that comes a lot of different types of pressure. So, you know, I do feel like it's a valid conversation to have, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely a tricky topic and not a great place for any artist to be. But that does wrap up the end of our questions for today. Do you have any guesses about what my topic for you is today?
I think you're going to talk about the Britney Spears conservative chip.
I am
free
not.
Free Britney!
I am going to talk about, you're on like the right track, but wrong artist.
Free Lady Gaga.
Free Kesha.
Oh, shoot. I knew it was going to be one of these ones. But yes, I remember very vaguely a couple things about that thing, that like situation that unfolded, but I don't know.
It's still everything. Unfolding.
What do you mean still unfolding?
She's not free of her label yet.
What?
Yes.
I thought this was like old news.
It is not, actually. This is like an ongoing thing. Like, literally, there's...
How is she... Sorry, not to interrupt. But how is she being owned by the label, though, if... Like, as far as I'm aware, she hasn't released any new albums in, like, years.
It's because she can't get out of her contract? Let's just jump right into it.
I'm ready.
So, Kesha Rose Siebert was born in Los Angeles, California on March 1st, 1987, and her mother was named Rosemary Patricia Peeb Stubert, and her mother is of German and Hungarian descent. One of Kesha's great-grandfathers was Polish.
Mm.
Yes. Her mother is also a singer-songwriter who co-wrote the 1978 single Old Flames Can't Hold a Candle to You with Hugh Moffat for Joe Sun, which eventually made popular by country music artist Dolly Parton, the queen herself.
Ah, yes, we love royalty.
Yes. Dolly, the only royalty I accept. it was for her 1980 album, Dolly, Dolly, Dolly. So Peeb was a single mother who struggled financially while supporting herself, Kesha, and Kesha's older brother, Lagan. They relied on welfare payments and food stamps to get by, which is unfortunate, mm-hmm, but mm-hmm, often a reality for many single parents.
Yes.
When Kesha was an infant, Peeb would often have to look after her on stage while performing, and Kesha says she has no knowledge of her father's identity. However, a man named Bob Chamberlain, who called himself her father, approached Star in 2011 with pictures and letters claiming them as proof that they had been in regular contact as father and daughter before she turned 19. But to me, that kind of feels a little sketchy because it's like he didn't even come out of the woodwork until she got famous. So I don't love it.
Yeah. And then on the other hand, too, it's like suspicious, but also is that just a testament to his character where he knew? Like, say in the situation that he is the father, it's like, oh, yeah, you knew who they were, but you didn't care about them, like you said, until they were famous or whatever, right?
Yeah. So, I don't know about that situation, but it is what it is.
It's gross.
So, Pete moved the family to Nashville, Tennessee in 1991 after securing a new publishing deal for her songwriting. She frequently brought Kesha and her brothers along to the recording studio and encouraged Kesha to sing when she noticed Kesha's vocal talent. Kesha attended Franklin High School and Brentwood High School, but claimed that she didn't fit in, explaining that her unconventional style, such as homemade purple velvet pants and purple hair, was not endearing to the other students. She played the trumpet and later the saxophone in the school marching band and described herself in an NPR interview as being a diligent student. Unlike me.
Or me.
So while attending high school, she was also taking songwriting classes and her mom was teaching her some songwriting skills as well. Kesha and her mom would often write together, and when she returned home from high school, Kesha began recording demos, which her mom would give to people she knew in the music biz. So Kesha was also in a band with her older brother called Dynamite Cop. Kesha and her mom co-wrote the song Steven together while Kesha was 16. I think that's on her first album, Animal.
I think so. Maybe.
Yeah. Kesha then tracked down David Gossman, a producer that she admired from Skritti Paluuti, who agreed to produce the song. She dropped out of school at 17 after being convinced by Max Martin to return to Los Angeles to pursue a music career and earned her GED after. And after attaining a near-perfect score on her SATs, she attended Barnard College, which is an affiliate college with Columbia University, but instead chose to drop out after 3 months to pursue her music career full-time. So around this time, her mom answered an advertisement from American reality TV series called The Simple Life. Have you ever heard of The Simple Life, Emily?
No, I don't have one. I've never heard of one. This is all new to me.
Ugh, you're missing out on the iconic show. So I'll give you a little rundown since you've never seen it or heard of it. Basically, Paris Hilton and Nicole Richie, they are both super rich heiresses, right?
Yep.
So the premise of the show, or at least the first season, is they went on a bus together and they would drive around to like small towns and do like normal people jobs with like no money in their pocket, and they'd have to earn the money, and like they could only spend what they had earned from these jobs. And it was obviously like this huge like clash of lifestyle for them because they were used to like all this luxury and they had to live like quote unquote simple folk. I don't know if you've seen this either.
It feels mildly classist.
It is, but for the time it was iconic. I don't know if you've seen this show either, but there was a show on Family Channel called Darcy's Wild Life that starred Sarah Paxton, and it was basically like kind of like inspired by The Simple Life, and they were kind of doing that whole shtick with it.
No clue.
Well, iconic.
I bet.
Truly. So her mom answered an advertisement for The Simple Life, and they were looking for an eccentric family to host Paris and Nikki, and the episode featured Kesha and her family, aired in 2005. The episode basically surrounded Paris, Nicole, and Kesha looking through the single ads in a newspaper and interviewing men for Kesha's mom to date, And it ends with them setting her up on a date with a man named Randy. I actually went back and watched this episode, and it's kind of funny. Kind of cringy. Very 2000s. Mm. But yes.
Interesting.
Yes. Well, they have the show streaming, I think, on Prime Video, if you ever want to check it out. I went through a phase early pandemic days, like I'm talking March 2020, of binging the show for some reason.
That's interesting. Yeah, I've literally never heard of the show.
It's a cultural moment in time for sure. Anyways, so Kesha had been recording demos for several years when eventually one ended up in the hands of Samantha Cox, who was a senior director of writer-publisher relationships at Broadcast Music Incorporated. That same year, Max Martin, who's like a super big music producer, really well respected, received one of Kesha's demos from Samantha, and he was impressed. So two of the demos were described in a later cover story for Billboard. The first was a gorgeously sung, self-penned country ballad. And the second was a gobsmackingly awful trip-hop track, where Kesha raps ad-lib for a minute and when she runs out of lyrics near the end. It was the later track that ended up attracting attention to kickstart her career and form the style of music that we really associate her with today.
Oh, okay. I thought it was going to go in a different direction. And I was like, oh, yeah, garbage, whatever. and then I actually, like, when you said that, I was thinking about her music and I was like, well, I mean, that is kind of her style, is what she did with the rap and whatnot. So that's when
yeah.
The anger really hits me.
I actually remember hearing about that like she was almost like a country star. I remember being like, Kesha? I could never even imagine Kesha being a country
Kesha.
Star.
That's really funny.
Yeah. So now we're going into Lucas Sebastian Gottwald, known professionally as Dr. Luke, Tyson Tracks, and Made in China. But for the purpose of this story, we shall refer to him as Dr. Luke from here on.
Okay.
That's how most people know him. So he, at the time that he met Kesha, was a guitarist for Saturday Night Live band, and he was really the protege of Max Martin at the time. So Dr. Luke had definitely already made a name for himself at this point in time when he first met Kesha. Mm-hmm. He had writing and producing credits on Kelly Clarkson's Since You've Been Gone, which was a huge hit. Mm-hmm. He later went on to have like a lot more big hits, you know,
okay.
As you do. So Kesha's demos eventually ended up in the hands of Dr. Luke because he was the protege of Max Martin.
Mm-hmm.
In 2005, at the age of 18, Kesha was signed to producer Dr. Luke's record label, Chemosub Entertainment and Publishing Company, Prescription Songs. Basically, Chemosub Records is owned by Sony Music Entertainment now. However, it wasn't initially when Kesha signed on in 2005. In November 2011, Sony bought the label, and Dr. Luke, who had created it, had an arrangement with Sony that involved him running an imprint, which basically meant that under his label, he'll write and produce music exclusively for Sony. But keep in mind that, like, Sony does this a lot, or Sony does have a lot, if not all, of the decision-making power for the label. So, like, he technically still runs his... He's basically running a label under their label, if that makes sense.
Okay, I think so.
But in 2005, when she signed on, this was not the case. He was just like, it was more of a small, independent operation.
Mm-hmm.
Was not big. Getting signed to Sony would have been huge at the time, but that's not what happened.
Mm-hmm.
So now I'm going to tell you about the first horrific encounter Kesha and Dr. Luke allegedly had. On this podcast, we believe victims, but I want to be clear that this is an ongoing lawsuit, and this information is all alleged.
Okay.
I just would like to make that very clear before we continue, because apparently Dr. Luke has a habit of not liking people speaking about this situation.
All right.
So, in 2005, allegedly, Dr. Luke and Kesha attended Nikki Hilton's birthday party and her sister Paris's at her sister Paris's Hollywood Hills home. According to Kesha's later lawsuit, an account from her mother, while at the party, Luke gave her the date rape drug GHB, and he allegedly described it to her as sober pills. He took her back to his hotel room and raped her while she was unconscious.
Okay.
So Kesha's mother says that she received a call from a disoriented Kesha the following afternoon, where she described waking up naked in his hotel room after blacking out the previous night. She said, quote, "Mom, I don't really know where I am. I think we had sex. I'm sore and sick. I don't know where my clothes are. I think I need to go to the hospital." She recalls, so that's what she recalled saying in that conversation. Mm-hmm. And Kesha ultimately did not end up going to the hospital. In a later affidavit, Kesha's mom said that her daughter told her, quote, "Mom, I just want to sing. I don't want to be a rape case victim. I just want to get my music out." And Kesha has kind of talked about this now, saying that she really regrets this decision because at the time she felt like if she went forward with the rape case that she would never
sing again.
Yeah. So she felt very trapped in the situation and decided that her career was more important to her than speaking out about this assault that had allegedly happened. Mm-hmm. So she chose not to at the time.
Okay.
In 2006, a year had passed since the alleged rape, and without Kesha releasing any music under Dr. Luke's label. So Kesha signs a management deal with David Sonnenberg's DOS Communications, which represented Black Eyed Peas and John Legend, in hope that they could sign her to a major label. DOS was tasked with obtaining a major label record deal for Kesha in a year's time in exchange for 20% of her music income, which is a big chunk of change.
Mm-hmm.
With her having the option of ending the relationship if they failed. So she worked with several writers and producers while at that company and ended up co-writing Australian pop group's The Veronica's single This Love with producer Toby Gad. While furthering her career in the studio, Kesha earned her living as a waitress. While struggling to get by, she began stylizing her name as $Ha, explaining that the dollar sign is an ironic gesture. So okay. Kesha said in a later interview, quote, "In less than 3 years, I've gone from being the worst waitress in LA to living out my childhood dreams of singing my songs to people all over the world." In 2008, Kesha appeared in the video for her friend Katy Perry's single I Kissed a Girl and sang background vocals for the song Lace and Leather by Britney Spears. DOS soon attracted the attention of A&R, which is Artists and Repertoire, which is a division of the record label or music publishing company that is responsible for like talent scouting and overseeing artist development.
Mm-hmm.
So she attracted the attention of songwriter Kara DeGardi, who wanted to sign Kesha to Warner Bros. Records. And that would have been great, but the deal fell through due to her existing contract with Chemosop, which is Dr. Luke's label.
Oh, okay.
In September that year, she allegedly terminated her contract with DOS. After leaving DOS, she ended up going back to Dr. Luke and agreed to have him bring her contract over to RCA Records, which was a Sony Music Entertainment subsidiary for distribution of future albums and singles. Both Kesha and DOS have since claimed in court that Luke coerced Kesha into leaving DOS, and Kesha once told her mother, quote, "Dr. Luke just called me and I have 24 hours to fire my lawyer and my managers and go back with him. Anytime I get a contract, he's going to come forward and basically say he owns me. What do I do?" So.
So then does he have any grounds at all, or is this like,
well, basically,
or is this all manipulation? Like, how is he able to get away with as much as he is?
Well, basically, because she originally signed with Chemosop, so he
can she not terminate that contract? Like, how does that work?
she must not have been able to without, like, his permission or something. Like, maybe that was in the contract that he had to agree to end it early. And so when she would get better offers, she would try and end that partnership to go with her new one so she could move forward in her career. And he just was halting her. So eventually, he basically was like, you gotta come with me or nothing, kid.
Right.
Which, allegedly, is how it's going down.
Okay.
So, despite their termination, Doss continues to keep finding Kesha new work. So, there's that. In early 2009, Kesha appeared on rapper Flo Rida's number one single, Right Around.
Ah.
Which, I never knew that she was the female voice in that.
I don't even think she's credited in that, is she?
She's not.
Huh. I never would pick that up. But I know what song you're talking about because I used to listen to it all the time.
I know. So that song exposed her to some mainstream attention. According to the parties present, the collaboration happened by accident. She had simply walked into a recording session for the song, and Flo Rida happened to have wanted a female voice on it. It was reported that Flo Rida liked the end result so much that he recorded one more track with Kesha for his album. However, she is not credited for her feature on the United States release of Right Round and did not collect any money for the part. She also refused to appear in the video, explaining to Men's Magazine Esquire that she wanted to make a name for herself on her own terms. But I still think it's kind of bullshit that she didn't get any money from that, considering how much money it probably fucking made.
Oh, it absolutely made a bunch of money. And it's in a bunch of movies and other things, too.
Yeah, that's a bunch of bullshit, if you ask me.
I would say so, too.
So at this point, Kesha has signed a multi-album deal with RCA Records, and having spent the previous 6 years working on material for her debut album, she began putting final touches on the album. She wrote approximately 200 songs for her first album, which is a lot. And Kesha then got her first solo hit with her debut single, TikTok, which goes on to spend 9 weeks at number one. And her first album, Animal, also debuted at number one in January 2010, selling 152,000 copies. It was certified platinum in the United States and had sold 2 million albums worldwide by September of that year. Kesha put forward a deliberately unpolished aesthetic and juvenile stage persona, which really matched the energy of her music. She described her own personality as, quote, times 10, quickly making her a deeply polarizing figure, and some of her critics found her output to be unsophisticated, while others felt that she was manufactured and lacked credibility. In 2010, Doss sued Kesha for $14 million in unpaid commissions on the work the company says that it got for Kesha after she ended their contract. They also sued Dr. Luke for $12 million allegedly interfering with their partnership with Kesha. In 2011, according to the deposition from a later lawsuit, it was revealed in the Doss case that Kesha allegedly alerted people involved in her career and personal life as early as 2005, shortly after signing her original deal, that Dr. Luke had, quote, engaged in certain unethical and unlawful actions against her, and that she did not want Dr. Luke to be part of her career going forward. However, in a deposition for Doss case that was partially unsealed in 2014 and that Dr. Luke would eventually use against her, Kesha testified under oath that, quote, Dr. Luke had never made sexual advances at me, quote, or gave her drugs or forced her to have sex. So like I said, she made that deposition, she says now, because she was afraid of losing her career so early in the game.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I don't love that.
No.
Lawyers for Kesha have since argued that Luke had, quote, threatened her safety and livelihood at the time of the deposition, which also included statements from Kesha's mother that might have corroborated Kesha's denial that Dr. Luke acted inappropriately. Kesha was ultimately ordered to pay a little over half the money to Doss that Doss claimed it was owed. In 2011, as I mentioned earlier, Dr. Luke co-founds his own Sony imprint, ChemoSub, and is made CEO of that label. Kesha, still under contract with Dr. Luke's KMI and RCA is brought over to the Kemosab label in the deal. So she has no choice in this.
Right.
Like, Sony acquired them, so she was acquired.
Yeah.
In 2012, Kesha and Dr. Luke's musical relationship took a turn for the worse. A New Yorker profile of the producer says their work on her sophomore album Warrior as strained, with Kesha wanting to expand her range to her rock roots and Dr. Luke telling her to stick to poppy club hits. Kesha tweets and deletes in later that year that she was forced to sing the lyrics on Die Young, which faced backlash after the Newtown Massacre. It was unfortunate timing that she had a song, We're All Gonna Die Young.
Yeah. That's rough.
She later hinted to the Rolling Stone magazine that she didn't have creative control over her music. In 2014, things unfortunately really started to heat up in this case, and Vulture magazine put together a timeline of events from 2014 to 2021. So I'm going to walk you through that timeline now. So let's just start with the year 2014.
Okay.
Travel back in time with me, Em.
Ooh, yes, we've just graduated high school. It's it's a time. It's not good, it's not bad. It's alive. We're there.
Truly.
Truly, yeah.
Okay, so January 2014. Kesha checks into Chicago rehab facility for 30 days to treat an eating disorder. Her mother gives a later interview blaming Dr. Luke for pressuring Kesha to lose weight, which Luke denies. While in rehab, she reportedly spontaneously tells doctors that Luke sexually and physically abused her and also drugged her. After completing treatment, she drops the dollar sign from her name and asks to professionally go by Kesha. She said, quote, I took out the dollar sign because I realized that was part of the facade. And she also said, it was a journey and I'm happy that was a part of my life, but I turned a corner. So on October 14th, the bombshell lawsuit, Kesha filed an explosive lawsuit against Dr. Luke in California claiming sexual assault and battery, including the aforementioned incident at Nikki Hilton's party, where he allegedly forced her to take the date rape drugs and sexually abused her afterward, and another where he violently thrashed his arms at her, which led to her running barefoot down the Pacific Coast Highway to escape.
That was going to be my next question, is because there was the one case where he allegedly performed these actions. Did anything else, like, was there multiple sexual allegations at all? Because usually when this kind of stuff happens once, it's a multiples situation.
So part of these, part of the lawsuit's sealed, so we don't know everything.
Okay.
But from what I've read, it kind of seems
to that.
It's alluding to that direction, that there's been multiple incidences.
Because that was my first thought, was for filing a lawsuit, if you've already taken a claim that the first or whatever action was not the case, but there's still an ongoing lawsuit, that to me would say that there's obviously layers to that. And usually in sexual abuse cases, if somebody can do something once and get away with it, it's a repeat action. And, again, not insinuating anything, but just kind of evaluating what you're telling me, he seems to like to keep her close to the pocket for lots of things, even if it financially benefited him for her to do certain things. And that, to me, says that there's also a personal relationship aspect of it.
I think so.
Yeah.
The lawsuit also accused Luke of long-term emotional and psychological abuse involving fat shaming. Kesha claims Luke's treatment has caused her severe depression, post-traumatic stress, social isolation, and panic attacks. She requests in her lawsuit to be released from her record deal with Dr. Luke, claiming his alleged actions are a breach of contract. No criminal charges were filed at this time. Also on October 14th, Dr. Luke files his own countersuit in New York against Kesha and her mother and manager Jack Ronver for defamation. He denies all allegations in the Kesha's lawsuit and claims it's a ploy to extort him, noting that she testified in 2011 that none of these allegations ever happened, as I mentioned earlier. On October 29th, Luke filed several defamation lawsuits against Kesha's mother in Tennessee, where she lives, in a case she tries to argue has no jurisdiction over her in New York. On December 2nd, during a radio interview, Lady Gaga says an unnamed music producer sexually assaulted her when she was 19. Kesha's former lawyer, Mark Gross, suggests on Twitter that Gaga was talking about Dr. Luke, which both Gaga and Luke deny. Still, her manager, Mark, claims he'll dispose Gaga for Kesha's lawsuit about her claims, and Luke responds by filing a defamation lawsuit against Mark, which is still ongoing. Mm-hmm. On December 3rd, Kesha's mom countersues Dr. Luke for causing her PTSD and says she has to be medicated due to the stress of his alleged abuse against her daughter and subsequent lawsuit. Now on to the year 2015, and we start on June 10th. Kesha adds Sony to her original lawsuit against Dr. Luke, arguing that her parent label had knowledge of and enabled Dr. Luke's alleged abuse for years and turned a blind eye to it. She claims Sony put Kesha in physical danger by allowing her to work with Luke, and that at least one other unnamed Sony artist was a victim of Dr. Luke's alleged abuse.
Now that's an interesting twist I didn't know about.
Huh. Yes.
That's a big fucking deal.
We're getting to it, but another very popular artist is about to get involved.
And it's not Lady Gaga.
Well, Lady Gaga is involved in the rest of this because her and Kesha actually became friends, mm-hmm, through this whole thing. And Lady Gaga has actually been, like, super supportive of Kesha over the years through all of this. Mm-hmm. Which I love to see because, you know.
Well, artists supporting artists. Yeah, like, they're all in the industry together. And if somebody's receiving unfair treatment, like, you'd hope to God that somebody would be out there to help you.
No kidding. All right. So, on June 17th, a judge halts Kesha's California lawsuit at the request of Dr. Luke over a dispute involving a clause in her contract with Luke's Kemosab Records, which states that all legal issues must be resolved in New York. Kesha argues that she signed a deal in California and that the alleged abuse outlined in her suit occurred in California. In September, Kesha files an emergency preliminary injunction request in New York court to be released from her record contract with Luke, claiming her career will suffer irreparable harm if she must wait until her sexual lawsuit is ruled on in order to be able to record new music without his involvement. Mm-hmm. She also requests that the court expedite its decision in her original lawsuit, and Sony speaks out for the first time, saying the label feels, quote, caught in the crossfire. And once Kesha's lawsuit against Sony and Kemosab dismissed, they called her suit, quote, transparent and misguided attempt to renew her contracts. Which, a great response from Sony.
No, that's a pretty unsympathetic response, especially from a case that's been ongoing for years.
Yeah. Jumping to 2016, on February 6th, Luke's defamation lawsuit against Kesha's mom and manager Jack Ronver are dismissed due to lack of jurisdiction. Days earlier, Kesha's mom tweets that Luke is allegedly refusing to pay Kesha her songwriters and producers because told the truth about him. She also claims that Luke forced her to give up songwriting credit on Kesha's last big hit, Pitbull's Timber. Mm. Which is a big deal because that would make her a big chunk of change. Mm-hmm. On February 19th, the injunction loss, in a devastating blow to Kesha's freedom, a New York judge denied Kesha's preliminary injunction to be released from her recording contract with Dr. Luke's label. The judge ruled that there, quote, there has been no show of irreparable harm, and notes that Sony and Luke have permitted Kesha to record new music without the direct involvement of Luke. Kesha's lawyers had argued this was an illusionary promise and that Sony and Luke would not promote her music, which Sony denied. Quote, you're asking the court to decimate a contract that was heavily negotiated in typical for the industry. The judge says Kesha is seen sobbing in court while dozens of fans from the hashtag Free Kesha movement started in the wake of her lawsuit rally for her outside the courthouse. So between February 21st to 25th, Kesha receives an outpouring of support from musicians and celebrities. Taylor Swift donates $250,000 to help assist Kesha with her legal bills. Jack Antonoff offers to produce for her and either leak it or, quote, wait on it until that creep can't block you anymore. Which, honestly, I already love Jack Antonoff, but that made me like him even more.
Well, and, like, not to distract from what you're saying either, but it speaks volumes that there's other people in the industry who work with big-name artists who at this point anyway, stepping up and being like, hey, like, this is bullshit. Like, for everything that's happened, like, this doesn't deserve to happen to you. You're being taken advantage of by this creep.
Yeah, and it's not okay.
No, and I think that makes a huge deal because it also, you know, changes the trust relationships between people and the asshole in general.
Exactly. Which we don't love.
Nope.
Lena Dunham writes a letter of support for Kesha and other victims of sexual abuse. Adele gives Kesha a shout out during her Brit Awards speech, and Lady Gaga personally meets Kesha and warns the public not to victim shame Kesha for going public about her abuse.
Good.
Because
people are like that. People will want to take the perspective of, oh, you know, not victim planning, but believing that, you know, well, this can't be real, this blah blah blah. But at the end of the day, like, it's not up to random ass people who don't know what's going on to decide what's happened to a person who has faced abuse in some way, whether it's, you know, in the way that you understand it or not, right?
Exactly. Also, it's just really hard for people who weren't there to judge the situation.
No.
On February 22nd, Dr. Luke speaks publicly for the first time about Kesha's lawsuit without going through lawyers. He tweets his innocence, saying, quote, didn't rape Kesha and never had sex with her, and that she was like my little sister. He maintains Kesha and her mom are motivated by money. And on February 24th, Kesha writes an emotional letter thanking her fans for their continued support. And she also responds to Dr. Luke's extortion claims, saying, quote, this has never been about renegotiation of my record contract. It was never about getting a bigger or better deal. This is about being free from my abuser. I would be willing to work with Sony if they do the right thing and break all ties that bind me to my abuser. Which I think is fair.
Yeah, I would say that's very fair, especially since Sony, with their position that they have the power to do that.
No kidding. And they could easily just keep her on their label and not have her work with him.
Literally. And also, at the other end of it, too, they're like, oh, like, we're done with this, blah, 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 blah. If you're actually done with it, then terminate the relationship, because then it wouldn't be a problem anymore. The relationship would be gone. So what's the holdup?
No kidding. On February 25th, fans planned a protest at Sony's New York City headquarters in response to the label's refusal to free Kesha. However, Sony shares a statement saying it is, quote, not in a position to terminate the contractual relationship between Luke and Kesha because the agreement exists outside Sony's purview. Which, I don't know the contract, obviously, but it sounds like a bunch of bullshit
to me. It sounds like a lot of baloney.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. On March 7th, Kelly Clarkson offers more support to Kesha, telling a radio host she was blackmailed by her record label, a Sony subsidiary, into working with Dr. Luke on Since You've Been Gone and My Life Would Suck Without You, or they would not have released her albums. She describes Luke as not a good guy, but does not speak to the specific allegations Kesha has made against him.
But, like, why is Sony so horny for this man? Like, sorry, but, like, there are multiple people with multiple talents and multiple things they can do and multiple connections out there. Why would you keep somebody on the roster who attracts such a bad name for the actions that they've performed throughout the years and obviously is not a good image for your company? That's the part I can't figure out.
I mean, why did Harvey Weinstein, why was he allowed to get away with what he did for so long? because the people that are already in those positions of power are hellbent on keeping themselves in those positions of power and are usually friends with the people who have the power to keep them in that seat.
Right.
Mm. And it's fucking bullshit and it makes me angry.
Yeah, because you're right. The only thing that would make sense in this is that there's lots of personal relationships that are obviously tying into it in ways that they shouldn't.
Exactly. On March 21st, the appeal, Kesha officially appeals the judge's decision to deny her injunction for freedom from her recording contract. She says that the ruling upholds form of slavery, enforcing her to work for a company and a man that she no longer wants anything to do with. On April 3rd, Kesha reveals on Instagram that Dr. Luke offered her a deal to release her from her record contract if she agreed to recant the accusation of rape made in her sexual assault lawsuit. Kesha refuses the deal, saying she would rather let the truth ruin her career than lie for a monster ever again. Which, honestly, good for her, and fuck that man.
Well, yeah, because then all it would do is hurt her credibility and make it so that he would still be able to contact other artists.
Yeah. On April 6th, a New York judge throws out Kesha's counterclaims of abuse against Dr. Luke, disputing that Kesha's argument in her injunction appeal that the terms of Kesha's agreement with Sony and Dr. Luke are a form of slavery. The judge states Kesha is acting unreasonably and that every rape is not a gender-motivated hate crime. The judge also cited a lack of jurisdiction and evidence. Between April to May, Kesha begins to rebuild her career, performing at Coachella and Dylan Fest, and released a song with Zedd. She also announces a tour with Major Lazer. On April 27th, Kesha's mom drops her countersuit filed in 2014 against Dr. Luke. May 3rd, Kesha follows her mother in removing Mark Gross from her legal representation. On May 22nd, Kesha wins her fight to perform at the Billboard Music Awards after Dr. Luke and Kimo Saab attempted to block her from singing on the show. They allow it on the grounds that Kesha can't mention Luke or the lawsuit. So, literally, I hate that. The fact that they're that micromanaging over her.
Yeah, because, again, from what you've been telling me since the beginning, it's like layers and layers of different types of abuse. As far as I can tell, like, even beyond, like, the whole, like, we spoke earlier about with the whole, like, rape case, for example.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, it even goes beyond that to, like, controlling and manipulation and withholding finances, and like it very much to me reads like so in the psychology of like people who are in relationships with narcissists or abusers, it's a lot of the same types of things. And these people are usually, you know, married to their abusers or in a relationship with their abusers, and in this case he is nothing more than her manager. So why on earth is there so much of this particular type of psychological abuse happening in the first place? It's already suspicious.
It's very suspicious. On August 1st, Kesha drops her lawsuit after nearly 2 years caught in a legal quagmire. Kesha drops her stalled California abuse lawsuit against Dr. Luke, and she instead delivers 28 songs to her label, which she said she financed completely by herself, and puts a sole focus on her New York case to be released from her contract. Later, she describes the situation surrounding her new music as songs that are just sitting somewhere waiting to be completed and polished and released. Luke disputes the claim, saying Kesha exiled herself. On September 1st, Dr. Luke sues Kesha's mom for a second time, claiming she didn't allow him to amend his original lawsuit with new complaints, but has continued to make defamatory comments about his alleged abuse. Moving on to 2017, and starting off the year on January 31st, Dr. Luke threatens to sue Kesha for defamation over texts she allegedly sent to Lady Gaga the week after Kesha lost her injunction, claiming Luke raped claiming Luke raped another artist. Mm-hmm. In a separate filing, Kesha accuses Luke of being unsupportive of her music and refusing to approve any songs, a release date, or agree to promote it. She claims Luke has financially cut her off and still not paid for any of her royalties from Timber. On February 15th, Kesha releases emails allegedly from Dr. Luke that she says support her claims and he emotionally abused her. In the emails, Luke appears to be to intimidate Kesha into dieting, saying, quote, A-list songwriters and producers are reluctant to give Kesha their songs because of her weight.
Which is not fucking true.
No. Luke claims the emails are taken out of context, but I don't know how you can take that out of context.
There is literally no way to miscommunicate that idea. Is that, like, what you said to me, what he had said, were, like, verbatim? Or is that, like, a summary, basically?
That's basically a summary.
Okay, so even with that, though, if that, like, there's no way of communicating that without having that intention. Like, how do you misconstrue that?
I genuinely don't know.
You can't. You can't misconstrue that. Oh, what was he actually communicating then? You know, like, people say something like that, and, oh, it was just taken the wrong way. Okay, so what way was it supposed to be taken in?
No kidding. It doesn't make any fucking sense to me. Mmm, anger. Anger, Emily, anger.
He's gross, and I don't like him.
On March 10th, lawyers for Dr. Luke moved to subpoena Kesha fan Michael Estelle, who runs a Kesha fan account on Twitter and helped organize Free Kesha protests. They claim Estelle closely coordinated with Kesha to spread defamatory statements and tarnish Luke's reputation. On March 21st, a judge rejects Kesha's amended countersuit against Dr. Luke, in which she sought freedom for her record deal for a third time, claiming Kesha didn't give appropriate notice to void her songwriting contract. For that reason, the judge says Kesha can't get out of her contract under the argument that Luke breached the covenant of good faith and fair dealing by allegedly abusing her. Kesha's latest additions noted that Dr. Luke's contract with Sony was coming to an end, which would put the fate of her new music in jeopardy, but the judge dismisses that claim as too speculative. The judge appears to imply that Kesha would have known that signing with Luke put her at risk. Quote, with respect to a prescription agreement signed on November 2008, Gottwood's allegedly abusive behavior was foreseeable.
Literally to who? Because she signed on, what, when she was 19?
Yeah.
You're telling me a 19 is supposed to have just magically all this knowledge on whether or not the person she's signing with is abusive or not? Give me a fucking break.
It's just, like, that's such a bullshit statement from a judge.
Because here's the thing. It rings to me the same way as, like, for example, in assault cases when they're like, well, what kind of underwear was she wearing?
I know. That's the same vibe it gives me, and I hate it. The
exact same vibe. And it's like, if in my opinion, who fucking cares? Who fucking cares?
It's like, that's completely irrelevant, sir.
It is completely irrelevant. It has nothing to do with anything. And as well, completely arbitrary. Because like I said, how would you, like, are women just supposed to have, like, abuser vision? Where you, like, lock eyes with somebody and you're like, that's an abuser. Like, I can't work with him. Like, you know, that's not a real thing.
No, it's not.
Especially not for a 19-year-old. When I was 19, like, you couldn't get me to drink anything other than, like, than, like, banana liqueur. Like, we're stupid people at 19. That's just how it is.
It do be facts. And also on March 21st, she faced another blow. The judge also shot down Kesha's attempt to use a California labor law to argue that her contract should have been terminated after 7 years because the suits are being battled in New York court. On April 25th, Dr. Luke exits as CEO of Kemosab at Sony after 6 years. He claims to still maintain a relationship with Sony, though the details are unknown. On June 23rd, Dr. Luke's Tennessee defamation lawsuit against Kesha's mother, originally filed in 2014, is dismissed. In a joint statement, Siebert says she, quote, admits that she had no firsthand personal knowledge of the events occurring on the night of the alleged rape. you know, because she wasn't there, but mm-hmm. her daughter did call her the morning after, you know?
Right, and how are you going to have a first-hand experience unless you're there? You can only go off of what you were told, which was within, what, 24 hours of the incident anyway, so why does that matter?
Yeah. On July 6th, Kesha releases her first solo song since the lawsuit, Praying, on Kemosab Records, which she announces her third album, Rainbow, will finally be released that summer. On July 30th, Dr. Luke subpoenas Lady Gaga in his defamation case over the alleged text Kesha had sent her accusing him of raping another artist. According to Luke's team, the texts Gaga provided were so heavily redacted it was incomprehensible. Gaga hits back, saying in a statement that, quote, Dr. Luke's team is attempting to manipulate the truth and draw press attention to their case by exaggerating Lady Gaga's role and falsely accusing her of dodging reasonable requests. On April 8th, Vulture reports that Dr. Luke will likely stand profit from Kesha's new album, and the New York Times adds that Luke will pursue the equivalent producer royalties in court from the album rather than have Kesha uphold the clause in her contract that states Luke must produce at least 6 songs on any album she releases, which is fucking bullshit, and I hate that he's getting any money from her at all.
He shouldn't. If he's not involved in the process at all, and it's just, like, a name tied into it. Like, why? Like, why?
On August 11th, Kesha's third album, Rainbow, and Kesha released her third album, Rainbow, which was her first since her legal showdown with Dr. Luke Bien, and was released on Kemosab/RCA. Dr. Luke's defamation lawsuits against Kesha and Garogo's, Kesha's countersuit, and part of Kesha's injunction appeal were still going on. On August 15th, Lady Gaga agrees to testify in Luke's defamation case and provide unredacted copies of texts Kesha sent her. The deposition was going to happen in September. On October 5th, in an interview with the New York Times, Pink says that she never will work with Dr. Luke again, saying, quote, I know that regardless of whether or not Dr. Luke did that, this is his karma and he earned it because he is not a good person, she says. Her comments are in solidarity with those of Kelly Clarkson, who also said she refuses to work with Dr. Luke in the future. In 2018, on January 28th, Kesha gave a powerful performance of Praying on the Grammy stage. The live musical moment felt particularly poignant against the backdrop of the Time's Up movement, in which Janelle Monáe invoked when introducing Kesha, whose legal battle with Dr. Luke was still ongoing. On May 29th, in a major setback to Kesha's fight to be freed from her record deal with Dr. Luke, a New York court sides with the previous judgment, who ruled that Kesha is not permitted to make any further appeals to be released from her contract in a court case pertaining to Dr. Luke's defamation lawsuit against her. On June 13th, the previously redacted text exchange between Kesha and Lady Gaga is released as part of a series of court documents filed by Dr. Luke in his defamation case against Kesha. According to the documents, in a text to Lady Gaga on February 16th, 2016, Kesha reportedly accused Luke of raping Katy Perry, in addition to alleging that she had also been raped by Dr. Luke.
Really? I never would have even, like, not saying that this happened, but of all the artists that I would, like, would have thought that she would have brought in, that I never considered her.
It's definitely an interesting, you know, twist. Yeah. So Luke's filing claims, following this text message conversation with Kesha's encouragement to Lady Gaga to spread negative messages about Luke in the press on social media. In July 2017, Gaga complied to a subpoena from Dr. Luke to turn over the unredacted texts, and the new court documents disclose that Perry had also given a deposition regarding the text conversation. Dr. Luke's legal team later issues the following statement. Quote, Katy Perry herself confirmed that Dr. Luke did not rape her. Kesha's accusations to the contrary, just like her other outrageous lies about Dr. Luke, is blameless or baseless and irresponsible, and it is disrespectful to both Katy Perry and Dr. Luke. On June 15th, Kesha's lawyers attempted to clarify the source of the Katy Perry sexual assault allegations, claiming the unnamed record label head had initially told both Kesha and Lady Gaga about the assaults. With regard to the text exchange between Kesha and Gaga on the subject, Kesha's legal team told Variety, quote, "It would have remained completely private except that Dr. Luke and his team took an email obtained only in discovery and decided to publish it to millions of people in his own amended complaint against Kesha and then claim reputable harm from his own widespread publication."
So basically, they were like, oh, like, this one thing may or may not even be true. And so he was like, oh, yeah, we're going to blast this and, like, hurt her credibility.
Literally, it's like if me and you were having a private text conversation, I said, I heard
blah, blah, blah,
this
random. And I was like, ah, yeah, man, I don't know.
And then literally someone out of context published that thing and was like, look, they're defaming me.
Mm-hmm.
And they're hurting this other person because it's not true.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, well, we don't, I mean, Katy Perry said it didn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know.
Right.
Obviously, you know, she says it didn't happen. That's, you know, what we should go with at this moment.
Right.
But, like, he's the one who chose to make that public information. No one knew who this unnamed celebrity was until he brought it up.
And literally, this guy could avoid so much problems if he would just let his contract go with her.
Literally.
Like, there's no need for any of this, really. Like, it's more trouble than it's worth at this point.
No kidding. I don't understand why this is still going on. So, Dr. Luke's legal representation promptly responds with a statement denying that the label CEO accused Dr. Luke of rape, concluding with a line from Sir Walter Scott's 1808 poem, Marmion. They altered the excerpt to target Kesha, with the bolded portion original to the team's legal statement, quote, "As the old and true adage goes, oh, what a tangled web you weave when you first you practice to deceive."
Is that, and who's that towards, though?
That's Dr. Luke's legal team towards Kesha.
Yeah, okay, one finger pointed forward, four of them pointing back, like...
No kidding. On August 27th, Katy Perry's deposition was released, along with a number of other testimonies from Dr. Luke's ongoing defamation lawsuit against Kesha. According to the heavily redacted deposition given in 2017, Katy Perry denies that she'd ever been sexually assaulted by Dr. Luke, an accusation Kesha and Lady Gaga attributed to an unnamed music label CEO. Court documents identify the CEO as Interscope Geffen AMA Records exec John Janik, who says he did not recall hearing or spreading rumors about Katy Perry experiencing any assault. So whether or not he told them, I feel like he's just trying to cover his butt at this point.
Right, like maybe it was a hypothesis at one point. He's like, oh, no,
I didn't say anything.
I didn't say anything.
Wasn't me.
However,
Gaga maintains in her deposition that Janik brought up the rumor to both her and Kesha during a meeting. Following the release of Perry's previous sealed deposition, Dr. Luke's legal team issues a statement claiming Kesha's allegation against the producer is part of malicious design to destroy Dr. Luke's business and reputation. On November 30th, recently released court documents reveal a text exchange from February 2016 in which Kesha and Lady Gaga call Katy Perry mean, which I don't know what that has to do with anything, but whatever. According to the text conversation, Kesha was upset with Perry for not coming forward about the allegation that she had been raped by Dr. Luke, and Gaga sent this message, quote, "I need to find sympathy and empathy for her. She's so mean, it's hard." Gaga replied, "Do you want me to see if I can talk to her? I know she's mean."
It's literally two friends. This would be like you and I talking about somebody that we happen to know who's mean, and it's just a conversation between friends. Like, why is this even involved at all.
No kidding. Like, this is a private conversation, so whatever. Gaga tweets the following to address the release text. At Katy Perry and I have grown up in the industry together. We've gone through both celebrations and differences with each other. These are old texts. We've matured, gotten over the past, love each other, and share deep respect. Katy is my friend and truly a kind soul. End of story. Mm-hmm. The legal battle continues into 2019, and on January 30th, Lady Gaga defends Kesha in her legal battle with Dr. Luke in a recently unsealed deposition, which took place in September 2017. According to the deposition, Gaga was in tears during the testimony, which her lawyers attribute to the singer experiencing PTSD from her own sexual abuse. Gaga began the deposition by recounting how she had first met Kesha in Dr. Luke's home studio and that Kesha had been in the back room wearing only her underwear.
Well, it definitely makes sense on why Lady Gaga backs her up the way that she does, because that's fucked up.
No kidding. If I went over to someone's house and I saw
two people who work together and one of them is sitting just in their underwear in a back room,
I would be like,
I call the police. I'd be like, 911. There is a woman in her undergarments alone in a back room in this man's house.
Send the police and send this man straight to fucking jail.
Like I said, it definitely makes sense to me anyways now why Lady Gaga is holding this the way she is, because she's seen already how the relationship was.
Is going.
And how it's been going.
Yeah. She cited the encounter when asked by Dr. Luke's lawyers if she believed the accusations of assault tarnished his reputation. Quote, so if you're going to ask what my view of his reputation, I made my view of him and his reputation when I saw her in that back room, Gaga said. Quote, that was an image that of something that happened to me, and I felt and knew in my heart she was telling the truth and I believe her. Yeah. On June 3rd, Kesha released Rich White Straight Men, her first song of 2019, on YouTube. And on October 21st, Kesha shared the trailer for her fourth album, High Road, noting that the project has a more positive outlook than 2017's Rainbow. Quote, when I wrote Rainbow, I was in a very different headspace. I had to address some very serious things, the singer says in the trailer. Quote, but now, on my record, I revisit my roots, appear in utter despotuous joy. Kesha got her balls back, and they're bigger than ever. Not much happened in 2020, but on January 31st, Kesha's fourth album, High Road, was released on Kemosab RCA. She serves as executive producer on the Exuberant project and is set to promote her new songs in a cross-country tour in the spring, but as you know, the COVID happened and that didn't happen.
Yep.
On January 6th, reigniting the case and delivering Kesha a severe blow, Manhattan Supreme Court Justice Jennifer Schuchter ruled that Kesha defamed Dr. Luke in a February 2016 text exchange with Lady Gaga, in which Kesha alleged that Luke had raped Katy Perry. And in the court decision, the justice writes, Kesha made a false statement to Lady Gaga about Gottwood and was defamatory per se. There is no evidence whatsoever that Gottwood raped Katy Perry. Moreover, publication of a false statement to even one person, here Lady Gaga, is sufficient to impose a liability. So the justice also ordered that Kesha pay Dr. Luke over $373,000 in royalties. Kesha's legal team plans to appeal the ruling. And with that, we are finally caught up to 2021. And on April 6th, Kesha's lawyer filed papers in the Manhattan Supreme Court arguing that New York's anti-slap free speech law should be applied to her case, Page Six reports. The law is designed to prevent wealthy people from filing frivolous lawsuits to intimidate and stifle free speech, which I feel like this situation applies to. Mm-hmm. Under the law signed by Andrew Cuomo in November 2020, if suits are found to be initiated in bad faith, encouraging only materialist or like only like frivolous litigation. Defendants must be awarded the cost association legal fees. While legal battles so far have revolved around whether Dr. Luke qualifies as a public figure, this legislation requires even private figure plaintiffs to prove actual malice on issues of public concern. On April 22nd, a New York appeal court holds a lower court ruling from 2020 that Dr. Luke is not a public figure. Two of the seven judges dissent on grounds that he is, at minimum, a limited purpose public figure. The court also affirms that Kesha's text to Lady Gaga was a defamatory statement and that Kesha can be held liable for statements made by her lawyer and press agent. And that is where we're at with the Free Kesha movement. Still an ongoing situation, but hopefully Kesha will gain autonomy over her music career very soon.
Ah, nice, but not nice.
That's yeah.
A lot.
It was a lot. I don't know how I feel about it, honestly.
I can't honestly say I know what to feel about it either. Since it's ongoing, I mean, I imagine we'll probably learn more as time continues. But, so far, it just, all in all, sounds like a really terrible situation. That's involved tons of people that have, like, really shouldn't have been involved anyways. And, like, if he had just been willing to dissolve the relationship when she wanted to dissolve the relationship, this would not be an issue.
Yep. And the fact that she's still being forced to release music under his label is not the vibe.
Nope, not at all.
I honestly did think that the situation was resolved when that single Praying came out.
Yeah.
Yeah, kind of shocked to learn that it was not over and it was still ongoing.
No, because I haven't heard anything, honestly, in years about the Free Kesha movement.
Yeah.
It's been mostly Free Britney.
I think the Britney talk has definitely kind of taken over the public, you know, consciousness. But yeah, the fact that she's still dealing with all this bullshit and the constant litigation for defamatory statements against Dr. Luke and whatever, and the fact that the court basically told her, like, oh, well, he's not a public figure, so your statements are defamatory.
The whole thing is bullshit, in my opinion.
Yes. But that does end our episode for this week. Hopefully you guys do something fun today that makes you feel better, because I think we should.
Yeah. So, yes, with that, if you would like to learn more about our show, you can visit us on our website, which is www.wheelofcrime.com. We also have a Patreon if you would like to donate to the show, which is wheelofcrime@patreon.com. If you would like to leave us a review at all, you can review us on iTunes, Apple Podcasts, Spotify. I don't know why I said iTunes. Maybe. And a 5-star review would be excellent if you could. Otherwise, we also have an email that you can email us at, which is wheelofcrime@gmail.com. And if you would like to follow us on our social media, we are available on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok at Wheel of Crime on all platforms.
Yes, and with that is the end of our episode for this week. We hope you have a great week, and we will be back next week with another new episode.
Whoop, whoop.
Okay, bye.
Bye.